So I guess the good news with this room is that if I'm not that interesting, you can sort of sneak to the side and like look out and see, right, this beautiful view that we have here. I was joking with Amanda, my colleague, and we were hanging out this morning that if we worked on the other side over there, we wouldn't get a whole lot done because we just would be staring out the window. But maybe that would make us more more creative. So I'm going to talk a little bit today about modernization. I've got really three perspectives on the topic. So three hats. I was thinking about wearing hats. I don't know if there are any Nationals fans out there, but if you're some Nats fans, yeah. Quite. I was at game three, so I'm still a little groggy from that, which was late Sunday night. I was home last night. I was much happier with last night's result than I was on Sunday. Okay, I could talk baseball for 20 minutes, but that's not why y'all came here. So three hats on modernization. So one is I'm an investor, right? So I sit on the Technology Modernization Fund or TMF board. So I'll talk to you a little bit about that and give you a perspective about, you know, how the government's thinking about using resources to invest in modernization. One is I'm a consumer of it. So in the Federal Acquisition Service in GSA, we spend about $150 million a year on IT. Now, a good chunk of it goes for lights on, kind of O&M stuff. But we do have a pretty significant reserve that we've created for systems modernization. And we've got a lot of modernizing to do of our system. So I'll give you a little bit of a perspective on that. And then the third perspective is as a provider. So the Federal Acquisition Service within GSA is a fee-for-service activity. So I run a big working capital fund, the Acquisition Services Fund. We have offerings. We take those offerings out to customers. And we charge fees on those offerings to pay for our people and the technology we invest in and training and our travel and all of those things. So I'll give you sort of my perspective as a provider of technology modernization services or offerings as well. So let's talk about the investor perspective first. So the TMF, most people are probably familiar with that, was a board created as part of the Modernizing Government Technology Act, which was part of the National Defense Authorization Act. Now, I've been in government in three different stints. 10 years as of this month, I did not know you could have an act within an act, but you can, right? So the MGT was within the NDAA. So it's a 7-member board chaired by the federal CIO, Suzette Kent. And we've been meeting for well over a year. We got $150 million to start with to go out and invest. We still have a little bit of that, money left. We've invested a number of projects across the government. Look, we know $150 million is not enough to modernize technology across the government. So we're looking to make some investments, what I would call kind of leading light investments in projects that we think can be representative and indicative of where we'd like individual agencies to put their money. So we've done some, you know, code conversion and refactoring at HUD. We invested in a number of projects at USDA in terms of some citizen-facing portal type work at farmers.gov. We made a pretty big investment in a project at the Department of Energy where they're transitioning to cloud-based email. So I'll talk about the energy project just a little bit because there's been sort of an interesting recent development with it. So we made an initial investment in the energy project. They went off. They've been working at it for a while. Part of what the board does is we get quarterly updates back. So we don't just kind of give out the money, right? We give out the money and then we ask the project teams to come back once a quarter and brief the board in terms of how they're doing. The dollars that we give are a loan, right? So there is actually clawback language in the act, right? So that the money is going to get paid back one way or another. From our standpoint, we look for good, compelling business cases that create value and generate savings, and that's how the agency is going to pay the money back. Energy's case was interesting as it's a big priority for the secretary to move everybody to cloud-based email. As they were working through the project, some of the different components within the department saw value in it and actually put some of their own money into it to speed things up and accelerate it a little bit. That allowed the Department of Energy to actually come back and give the board a little bit of that original investment back. They essentially said, hey, we didn't need quite as much as we thought we needed, which from our perspective, you know, when's the last time somebody in this town gave you money back, right? Doesn't happen that often. And because they got buy-in from some of the components, they were able to shorten the payback window for the money from the TMF that they are using by about a year. So that, from our standpoint, was a pretty good news story, and we were pretty excited about that. So the kind of themes and the investments we're making, as I said, looking to sort of make leading light investments, really thinking about investing incrementally. So asking people, hey, what do you need in total to get the project done. We like to co-invest. So we like it when agencies are putting some of their own money in as well alongside ours. And we like to give the money out incrementally. I mentioned those quarterly reviews, right? So we're looking at projects. If things are getting off track, we could potentially stop an investment or pull it back. More likely what we do is, you know, kind of offer some advice and guidance to try and help get it on track. So that gives you a little bit of a sense for TMF. And my perspective as an investor on that board. So let me talk about my perspective as a consumer of IT modernization. So I mentioned we have about $150 million a year budget within the Federal Acquisition Service. So we run the Schedules program, we run Alliance and Oasis, we run SAM, a system for award management, right? So if you're a vendor and you want to get paid by the government on a contract, you've got to get registered in SAM. If you're a grantee and you want to get paid, you've got to register in SAM. So we have a pretty, you know, pretty decent size IT portfolio. So about 2 weeks after I took the job, and you're getting all these briefings from everybody, the CIO shop comes in and they say, hey, we want to give you sort of a sense for what you have in your IT portfolio. Said, okay, great. So we're into the briefing. They put a slide up on the screen, got 170 plus systems across the Federal Acquisition Service that we use to run our business, right? And then the next slide was a data flow slide, right, in between all those systems. It looked like a bunch of spaghetti on the wall, right? Very complex. So the first thing I said was, gosh, it'd be great to get to think more about capabilities rather than all these individual task-based systems, and to try and dramatically simplify that environment, which means we're going to have to create some dollars for modernization. So we've set about doing that. We kind of changed our relationship with the CIO shop. We thought a little bit differently about how we interact with industry. So we just awarded a new contract called Comet. CIO Modernization Enhancement and Transformation is what the acronym stands for. And that really puts us, contrary to the last contract we had to do all our modernization, which essentially we had a single large and a single small vendor. We went to those vendors for ROMs to get the work done, and then those were the vendors that actually did the work for us, right? We kind of broke that up into a couple different contracts. We've got an advisory type contract where we get the ROMs done and they help the government do some sort of engineering and architecture work. And then we've got a competitive pool of 12 vendors on a BPA off the Schedules program, 8 large and 4 small. And we're going to compete those requirements out among those vendors on a task order basis. So a little more work from the government standpoint in terms of managing multiple task orders, but I think we're going to get some good competition, some better pricing, and I think a little bit more thought leadership and innovation in terms of how we modernize our portfolio. The two big areas we're focused on, one is contract writing. So we're the Federal Acquisition Service. We have almost 1,000 1102s or contracting officers that work in our organization. We write and manage a lot of contracts. We have, and it depends how you count, which is an indicator that there's a problem, somewhere between 36 and 45 different systems that a contracting officer in the Federal Acquisition Service uses to write and manage a contract. On average, a CO logs into 14 different systems in a week to get their work done. And sometimes there's some still fat fingering of data, right? That's a little crazy from where we are today. So that's a big focus. That's one of the things I heard from the workforce when I first got there is, you know, hey, we want to go do a good job taking care of our customers, but it's a little tough for us because our system sort of impede some of that, take up time, and place a little bit of burden on the workforce. So we're focused on an enterprise contract writing system, single source of data, single workflow with some variance for different communities within the Federal Acquisition Service. So that's one big push. The other big push is around data, really, right? So we're calling it our common catalog effort. So we have a catalog of north of 50 million items that we represent out. These are basically the offerings that our vendors bring to our channel and that we help them then sell back to customers. Products is easy to get your arms around, but we actually do more business in terms of services than products, and those are offerings too. That data is also siloed in lots of different little places across the enterprise. So we put a group together to take a look at creating a single source of data, a single source of truth to manage all that across GSA, at least across the Federal Acquisition Service. that effort is a little bit further behind the contract writing effort. So for contract writing, you'll probably see an RFP in Q1 of FY20 bid out on Comet. Catalog, they're still in sort of the blueprinting phase, but my sense is that hopefully there'll be some sort of competition before fiscal year 20 is out there. So that's a couple big areas we're looking at in terms of IT modernization just within GSA. So that's my sort of consumer of IT modernization hat. So let me talk last about my perspective as a provider of IT modernization. So if you think about what we do, I mentioned we have vehicles, right? So we put in place these government-wide solutions like Schedules or like Alliant that people can use in order to drive IT modernization within their organizations, right? And from our standpoint, you know, we sort of do some of the upfront work, cut cycle time down for agencies, but our role to a large extent is passive there, right? Once we've put the vehicle in place and got the right vendors on board. We've got a set of programs we run that also help agencies modernize. So in that category, I'd put things like EIS, the Enterprise Infrastructure Solutions, which is a contract, but also has a pretty significant transition ordering assistance component to it. And it's really something where, you know, we're kind of in the boat with the agencies in terms of trying to help them modernize their network infrastructure. And that's a shared responsibility. Usually we get beat up when things go a little more slowly than are planned. That's just sort of one of those are some punches that you have to take when you're in the role that that GSA is in. But I've been pretty heartened by the progress we've made there. There are nine primes on that contract. Five of them have ATOs. We expect the other four to have ATOs by the end of the calendar year. I think a couple of them, I'm hopeful, will have ATOs before we all sit down to eat turkey. So good progress on the vendor side. Agencies have started to get RFPs out. There have been some awards. Early award was NASA, Justice, Social Security Administration just made an award as well. So we started to see some awards. We expect activity to really pick up here, particularly 31 March is sort of a deadline for when some of the risk is going to be put back on the procurement execs and the CIOs at the agencies in terms of if they haven't actually done gotten through transition yet and made some awards, they're going to sort of be responsible for the sole source bridge and that sort of thing that we need to be put in place there. Another IT modernization program we have that gets a lot of chatter, a lot of press, is the Centers of Excellence Initiative within our Technology Transformation Services, or TTS group. So COEs are working with, I think, about a half dozen agencies now. It's really kind of top level, agency level transformation. Right, focused in areas like cloud, data analytics, customer experience, contact center. Right, those are the key areas they're working in. They just announced some agreements with Consumer Product Safety Commission. Big agreement that was just announced with DoD's JAIC, or Joint Artificial Intelligence Center. That was for me particularly gratifying to see. You know, TTS was at one time actually. Just when I took the job almost 2.5 years ago, was a separate service. And kind of the first task I had was to integrate that into the Federal Acquisition Service and do it in a way that was hopefully drama-free and ended up creating some synergies between the two groups. And that joint artificial intelligence work that the COEs just kicked off here within the last few days actually started as a conversation with some executives in our information technology category portfolio, our ITC group, right, who were over talking to the Jake about use of some GSA contract vehicles. They had their good listening ears on. And as part of that conversation, they heard some things they thought would be appropriate for COEs. They brought that back in, got some folks from the COEs engaged, and that actually led to the engagement that, as I said, had just recently kicked off. So, for me, that was gratifying, right? Because you start to see some synergies within the group and see how this could sort of all fit together and work together nicely. So that's a little bit of a perspective on IT modernization as a provider. You know, there are some things we do that you might call a shared service. So we have an assisted acquisition group. FedSIM, many of you probably know FedSIM. FedSIM's part of that assisted acquisition group. It's actually the largest of 12 what we call client support centers that we maintain that help customers go from sort of requirement all the way through to award and then administration of the contract all the way out and sort of do that, all that work in a comprehensive project-based way for a fee. That assisted acquisition group has been growing at about a 20% clip per year for the last 3 years. And this year, or I guess I should say last year, FY19, they did more than $10 billion in obligations. It was the first time they passed the $10 billion mark. So it's pretty big. It's pretty significant. Some interesting things going on in that group. Some trends, you know, maybe 5-6 years ago, that group was buying a lot of what I would call sort of commodity type IT, help desk, tier one, tier two sort of stuff, right? The customers were kind of stitching together. They've really transitioned. They this year did more what I would call true professional services than kind of true IT type engagements. They did a lot of ISR work for DoD, intelligence, surveillance, and reconnaissance work. And we've really seen customers in all different areas move to buying things as a service. We've kind of been hearing about that for a while. We're really seeing it in the numbers, right? So customer goes and buys ISR. They want a contractor to come, operate the platforms, pull the data down, get it back to a certain place, maybe even do some analysis of that data, and then provide that, you know, as a service in a way to the government. So it's been really interesting to kind of see that trend in our FedSim business and our assisted acquisition business overall. You know, the other area that you could sort of call like a shared service is our 18F group, right, which is really out doing project-based kind of IT transformation work for customers. Been pretty proud of that group. Those are kind of the original digital whiz kids, at least at GSA. And they've really done some great work over the course of the last year and a half to get themselves to a point where they're on a much more stable financial footing than they were previously. Because just like the rest of us in FAS, we're a fee for service activity, so we like everybody to kind of be able to stand on their own two feet when it comes to finances. So those are my perspectives on IT modernization, investor, consumer, provider. I would say, from my perspective, when you think about getting modernization done in the federal government, I don't think it's not really a technology challenge. There are lots of good tools out there. I think of it as more of a people challenge. I think, you know, you need some steady, stable leadership to help drive it, particularly to drive it. It's easy to do it at the top of the agency, right? Hey, the secretary's for digital transformation, you know, let's go do this, right? It's when you get maybe three levels down, right, to the 14s and 15s in the organization, are they bought in, right? Do they see something in it for them? Are they measured in a way that will help drive transformation, right? That's tricky. Some agencies are better at it than others. Your tools are somewhat limited in the federal government in terms of the personnel system, in terms of how you can drive the kind of behavior that you want to drive. You got to get buy-in from the workforce also. I definitely found that within the Federal Acquisition Service, right? The areas we picked to go after for modernization were things that we heard from the workforce were pain points for them. And so we said, hey, if we think we can get the line level people to buy into this, seems more likely to stick because there's always a period in a modernization project where everyone says, change the old system, get rid of it, right? And so you make the change and everyone says, God, I miss the old system, right? And so you sort of go in that, you know, valley of whatever you want to call it. You got to have the line level folks with you, bought in from the beginning so they feel like they own it, because eventually you will sort of start to come out of it, right? People aren't bought into it. You might get down in that valley and never get out, right? People sort of write you off. And then I think in terms of resources, TMF's a great example. And individual agencies have this ability as well. Not everyone knows how to, my sense is not everyone in the government knows how to use it perhaps as effectively as they could, is to use working capital funds, right? Create working capital funds, get them funded, which is something that OMB is working on, right? To sort of be able to have agencies prime the pump a little bit. Those working capital funds can cross fiscal years, can be a little bit more patient, can, you know, create a kind of a balanced portfolio where you do some sort of simple things that have to be done from modernization perspective. Maybe you take a couple of little riskier bets on emerging tech and see if you can get some big, you know, some big payoffs, right? And then the idea, right, is that the savings that are created from those investments flow back into the working capital fund and generate additional investments. I'm having run a big working capital fund in the government now for almost 2.5 years. I believe there's a lot of potential there. Just not everybody knows how to use those levers in the most effective way possible. And I think, you know, the one piece of the MGT Act that nobody talks about is it created the ability for the CFO, 24 CFO Act agencies to have working capital funds for IT modernization. And so I think, in addition to just the sort of macro TMF fund, the ability to get those working capital funds at the agency level stood up, funded, and functional could really drive a lot of great change, a lot of great modernization work across the government. Okay, so with that, I'll stop. They said we were going to do a few questions, so I am happy to take questions. I'm kind of riding free and easy now, right? Friday is my last day in the office. And I'm taking a month off to clear my head, and then I'm going back to work in the private sector. So I'm happy to take questions. I can hear you okay. I don't know if the group can. I can hear you fine. But
all right, is that better?
Oh, that's a lot better.
You mentioned TMF, and I'm part of a large modernization effort at my agency.
Where are you from?
State Department.
State. Okay.
And you mentioned I just had a Spanish Inquisition with OMB based on my 21 funding. They're like, "Why do you need this money and all this?" So how is OMB involved in what you're doing with Suzanne Kent and that TMF and some of those others? Because that seems to be the challenge right now. Is what do we say to OMB to convince them that we need the modernization dollars? Because my situation is I have a large footprint of IT to support global mission. Mm-hmm. They're saying, "Well, you get all this money, you should modernize." I'm like, "Well, that money goes to O&M. Yeah. I need more money to do modernization." And when I ask for more money, they're like, "Look at all this money you're spending." I'm like, "Yeah, I have to keep the lights on and I have to build something new."
Yeah. So, this is the challenge, right? Of sort of, I face the same thing within Federal Acquisition Service. You got to fix the plane, modernize the plane while flying it, right? You can't say, "Hey, we're going to stop doing contracting for the next 9 months while we get our act together on modernization." That's a non-starter, right? As crummy as the existing systems may be, and oftentimes they are, you can't shut them down, right? But conversations with the M side and the B side are often different, right? They're different kind of people that are drawn to those two sides of OMB. The M side comes first. Remember that. The examiners, right, are, you know, a little more nuts and bolts focused. You know, I think you've got to just work hard to make the argument that, look, the initial investment goes up, right? Because I've got to do two things at once. I've got to keep lights on because I've got mission. Right, we're not going to not engage with foreign countries around the world for 9 months while you get your IT modernization plan in place, and you're going to have to spend some dollars to modernize on top of that O&M. Now you should be able to show a pretty credible case for, hey, over time, I think I can get maybe for the same dollars leveled out better capability, or maybe even you know, fewer dollars and better capability. Yeah. Yeah. I think you got to talk benefits there, right? Impact to mission and things like that in terms of what the investment enables. Because you're right, it's not a, you know, it's not a dramatic savings. Now there are some areas, some emerging tech areas, you know, I think things like RPA, robotic process automation, potential use of AI, where you can sometimes see business cases where you get really, really dramatic returns on it. So, you know, you got to have sort of a balanced portfolio. Yeah. Well, but you know what? That's something OMB can help you with, right? Give us the flexibility to do that, right? I mean, that's why you go to Executive Office of the President for some top cover on things like that. If you want to drive real change, okay, it involves technology, and technology usually is driven by business process and impacts people, right? So you got to help me on the people side. If that's, right, if I need fewer people, I can get more capability to run my business. You got to help me with that, right? I mean, I think that's a legitimate ask to have back of OMB.
Your time for one.
One. Well, how about you? I think she had her hand up first. We'll go. Tell me, I talked too long. I talked over the Q&A.
So, the kind of collaboration you're talking about, it's a little bit more centralized. Do you have multidisciplinary teams that go out? Because technology acquisition, first you need to know what problem you're trying to solve, mm-hmm. and then you need to know what data or systems are already available. You need to map those to whatever modern technology is available, and then you need domain knowledge to make sure that that transition happens. So how do all those people come together?
So are you referring to a specific part of our, are you talking about internal for us, or are you
internal?
Yeah. So, what are those? Those are pretty cool. Caught my eye. I knew the windows would be distracting, right? I think they're American, so we're in good shape. But you never know. Okay, so internally within they're taking some State Department data to the cloud, is what I heard. Yeah. Internally within GSA, we did create interdisciplinary teams, right? So we have, within my group, we have six what we call business portfolios. So those essentially have service offerings. They outserve customers, and they're treated almost as like little profit and loss centers in and of themselves. And then we have four offices that are integrator offices, basically overhead, that provide services across those portfolios. So what we did was, say for contract writing, right? We took a director, right? Somebody who'd been a line level contracting officer who rose to the organization. We kind of pulled that person out of their line job, and we gave them the responsibility for creating an interdisciplinary team from across the portfolios with the right functional expertise to go and build requirements and engage with industry and get us all the way to RFP. So that was an interdisciplinary team, and there that team's going to actually stay together and sort of get us through the initial implementation, and then we'll make a transition where we go from kind of standing up the project to putting it into one of our integrator or cross-cutting offices that's responsible for managing systems, the aptly named Office of Systems Management, and that's where that contract writing, enterprise contract writing effort will have a long-term home. So we made a very conscious decision, right, to take people who knew the business, people who had felt the pain of the 36 systems and the 14 logins, right, and that sort of thing, and bring a group of them together who had credibility with their peers and who really could be owners, felt like they had a real stake in this, right? Hey, I'm going to use this new system, right? So I gosh darn well want it to be pretty good. And then I'm able to go back and talk. You can't create a group of 1,000 people. That doesn't work, right? But I'm able to go back and talk to my colleagues, and I'm someone with credibility who my colleagues believe in, right? And that's the sort of the way we chose to approach it. Now, I will tell you, that is different than how projects sometimes get approached, particularly in the federal government. So in my mind, having been a consultant for a little while in my life, sometimes leaders will come in and they sort of do some listening, they get some ideas, and they get some initiatives they're going to go after. They'll oftentimes hire an outside team, right, of pretty smart people, and they'll sort of drive, they'll try and drive the change top down through that team, right? And that is, at least initially, often quicker in my experience, but it doesn't usually have the staying power. So we literally flipped that model on its head and said, I don't actually want any consultants in here telling me, sort of how to drive change and how to do this from the beginning. I want to do a bottoms up with our own people, right? If we need extra arms and legs once we start rolling out to do change management, communication, and that sort of thing, we'll do it, and we'll probably hire from the outside to get help. But the thought leadership behind it will be government thought leadership. For us, we could do it in this instance because we have the domain expertise here, right? We know acquisition, we know contracting, we have people who have great credibility there. So if you didn't have that domain expertise, maybe we'd need to bring that in from outside the organization. But in this case, we did not, right? And so we chose this kind of bottoms up strategy to drive it. Okay, I think that's it. I don't know where the hook is, but there's the hook. Okay, cool. Well, thanks. Great talking with you all this morning, and I hope you all have a great day.